All right, welcome back to our next lesson on hemodynamics. In this lesson, we are going to be talking about our cardiac output, as well as the different factors that go into determining what is our cardiac output. And so just for a little refresher, let's go ahead and throw up our cardiac output equation. So again, we have our cardiac output is equal to our heart rate times our stroke volume. And again, let's just hit on our normals again. Stroke volume, normal is going to be 60 to 120. Heart rate is going to be 60 to 100. Cardiac output is going to be 4 to 8. Unless you're looking at our cardiac index, then you're going to be 2.5 to 4. Now, one really important thing to know about our heart rate and our stroke volume in this equation is that they work together almost in a seesaw-like manner. So let's say we have our heart rate over here and our stroke volume over here. Our heart rate is going to compensate for changes in our stroke volume. So if our stroke volume is high, we're going to have a lower heart rate as a result. And by the same token, if our stroke volume were to decrease, then we would see our heart rate increase in an attempt to compensate for that decreased stroke volume. So without much ado, let's go ahead and move on to the first component of our cardiac output, which is going to be our heart rate. And like we just talked about with the heart rate, the big important thing with the heart rate is its goal or its job is to compensate. So it's going to compensate for changes in our stroke volume. So let's say, for example, we have decreased stroke volume. What this is going to lead to is an increase in our heart rate, which oftentimes we refer to as tachycardia. So again, that heart rate is trying to speed up in order to give us more beats per minute because our stroke volume is now a smaller volume. Some of the things that are going to contribute to tachycardia are going to be hypovolemia. And this could be as a result of dehydration, fluid loss, or even blood loss. Another thing would be low blood pressure. Also, if we think about our sympathetic nervous system, so this is going to be our fight or flight. So if you think about in those situations, the body releases the catecholamines, which are going to increase your heart rate. And then also other things like fever or even something as simple as, and I know I don't do enough of this, exercise. These are all going to be things that are going to increase our heart rate. One important thing to know when we're talking about tachycardia as a form of compensation is there are limits to how much we can compensate for decreased stroke volume by increasing our heart rate. So if we have a normal, healthy person, typically a heart rate that's greater than 180 beats per minute, if you have a rate that is faster than that, you're not going to have enough time to fill the ventricle between each beat. And as a result, if you continue to increase your heart rate, you're not going to see an increase in your cardiac output as a result, and therefore it's no longer going to be able to compensate. Now, this is in a healthy heart. So if you have someone that has either a deconditioned heart or a diseased heart, oftentimes anything that's greater than 120 beats per minute is no longer going to be able to compensate. So important things to keep in mind as your patients are becoming increasingly tachycardic, that at some point, and depending on the health of their heart, it's no longer going to be doing them any good and in fact may be hurting them. So now on the flip side of tachycardia, if we are in a situation where we have an increased stroke volume, this is going to lead to a decreased heart rate. And this is what we refer to as bradycardia. Now, one great example of this we often see in our athletes. And if you think about with these patients, they have very strong cardiac muscle, so they have a great stroke volume. And as a result, their heart rate is going to compensate and lower. And so a lot of times you'll see these patients with heart rates in the 40s and 50s, and they're totally fine. Now, the last important thing to talk about when we're talking about our heart rate are things that can lead to alterations. So either alterations in the regularity or alterations in the physical beating of the heart. So for example, if we talk about patients that have arrhythmias, so if they are in AFib, a flutter, let's say they're in a junctional rhythm or even an idioventricular rhythm, this is going to have an effect on both our heart rate and the examples of either slow rates with junctional or idioventricular rates or fast rates such as AFib or aflutter. But these arrhythmias can also cause dyssynchrony between atria and ventricle, which can also impact our cardiac output. Another thing that's going to have an impact on our heart rate is if we have different heart blocks. And this is primarily going to be our second degree and third degree blocks, but these are going to impact our heart rate and, again, will have an effect on our cardiac output. Also, if a patient has had an MI, this can as well have an impact on our heart rate. And then finally, if our patients are on either beta or calcium channel blockers. These medications are all going to have an impact on our patient's heart rate, as well as their ability to compensate in situations where their heart rate may need to increase in order to make up for decreased stroke volume. All right, so that covers everything with our heart rate. So let's go ahead and move on to the next component of our cardiac output, which is going to be our stroke volume. So once again, for a refresher, we'll go ahead and put our cardiac output equation. So our cardiac output is equal to our heart rate times our stroke volume. And if you remember, we talked about our stroke volume is primarily composed of three factors. And those three factors are, again, our preload, our contractility, and our afterload. And so let's go ahead and talk about these different factors. And to start off, we're going to talk about our contractility. And so to put it simply, contractility is simply the squeeze that your heart is able to do. So this is going to be the force of the contraction that the heart or the ventricle is able to beat with each time it contracts. So as an example, if we have an increased contractility, this is going to lead to an increased stroke volume. And so if we think about it, the more squeeze we have, the more blood that we're going to eject with each contraction. As a result of that, though, this is going to lead to an increase in our myocardial oxygen demand. By having that increased squeeze, it's going to take more energy, more force from the heart, and as a result, it's going to require more oxygen to do so. Things that can lead to increased contractility would be things like, again, our sympathetic nervous system, and again, like we talked about, that fight or flight system will not only increase your heart rate, but it will increase your contractility. And then also things like exercise. Now again, on the flip side of this, if we have a decrease in our contractility, that's going to lead to a decrease in our stroke volume. But as a result, we are then going to have a decrease in our myocardial oxygen demand. And some of the things that can lead to a decreased contractility would be if your patient has had an MI, if they've had cardiac surgery, things such as hypoxia, hypercapnia, hyperkalemia, or hypocalcemia are all things that can lead to decreased contractility. And then finally, metabolic acidosis can also have a negative effect on the contractility of your heart. Okay, so moving on to the next factor in our stroke volume is going to be our preload. And our preload is often referred to as our filling pressure. Essentially, the preload is the amount of blood that's in the ventricle prior to contraction. A lot of times you'll hear this referred to as how full the tank is. So essentially, it's that filling pressure, how full, how much volume do we have in order to aid in contraction. Now with our preload, there are three main factors that play a role in determining what our preload is going to be. So the first of these is going to be our blood volume. So essentially, if you don't have any blood, you're not going to have any volume for your preload. Next is going to be the distribution. And this is referring to the distribution of fluid and volume in your body. Is it in your vasculature? Is it inside of the cells? Or is it in the third space? What is the availability of that volume to contribute to preload? And the last factor that we hit on just briefly when we were talking about the heart rate is going to be our atrial contraction. And really what we're asking is the atria beating in conjunction or in synchrony with our ventricle? As we know, when the atria contracts, it forces that last bit of blood into the ventricle, really filling it prior to contraction. And this atrial kick can actually account for as much as 20% of our stroke volume. So if our atria is not beating in synchrony with our ventricle, for example, in a fib or a flutter, then we're not going to get that good atrial kick and we'll have an impact on the preload. In order to really understand preload and have an idea of how it is that it impacts our stroke volume, you need to understand something called the Frank-Starling law. And the basic concept behind the Frank-Starling law is an increase in preload equal an increase in our stretch of cardiac muscle, and this equals a stronger contraction. And the best way to really kind of understand this or visualize this is if we take, let's say we imagine a rubber band here. If we take that rubber band and we stretch it out, when you let go, that rubber band is going to snap back with more force. And so again, if we stretch it out even further and we let go of that rubber band, again, it's going to snap back with even more force. And that's the basic principle behind the Frank-Starling law. As we increase that preload, it's going to stretch the ventricles more. And by stretching those ventricles more, they're actually going to be able to have a stronger, more forceful contraction in ejecting the blood. Now, there is a caveat to the Frank-Starling law in this concept of stretching and stronger contraction. And that is that there are times that you can actually overstretch the heart so that it's not able to contract as forcefully. And this is going to be when we're talking about congestive heart failure. And so it is going to be important that when we are talking about preload and the Frank-Starling law, that we do talk about a concept called compliance. And with compliance, there's two different things that we worry about with our compliance. We can either have an increase in our compliance, or we can have a decrease in our compliance. An increase in our compliance is often referred to as overstretch. And this you're going to see in patients that have CHF or a dilated cardiomyopathy. So essentially the heart has too much compliance. It's able to stretch too much. And as a result, you're not able to get that forceful, strong contraction that you need. Now on the opposite end, a decrease in compliance is not going to be able to stretch or accommodate. And you might see this in patients that have had an MI, in patients who have a restrictive cardiomyopathy. And also in patients who have a stunned myocardium, and examples of this would be trauma or cardiac surgery. So again, that compliance will play a role in the heart's ability to effectively deal with the volume or the preload that it is receiving. All right, so let's go ahead and move on to the last factor that impacts our stroke volume, and that is going to be afterload. Now, afterload can be simply summed up as resistance. So essentially, how hard does the heart have to beat in order to eject its blood? This is also something you'll commonly hear referred to as how clamped down is the patient. And just to give you a little visual representation, if we have our heart, and let's say we've got a nice big wide aorta to beat in, it's going to be a bit different than if we had one with a tighter or more restricted aorta, because essentially afterload is that resistance that the heart is having to overcome each time it's beating to try and eject its blood. Now with this as well, we are going to have three factors that are going to impact our afterload. The first of these is going to be the compliance of the aorta. Now the compliance of the aorta is talking about its ability to stretch with each beat. So if you have a more compliant aorta, when the heart beats, it's more easily able to stretch, as opposed to a non-compliant aorta, which is going to be a stiffer aorta. And as the heart beats each time, it's going to be beating up against a stiffer vasculature. The next factor that plays a role in our afterload is going to be just that, the vascular resistance. And that's exactly what I just drew above with the pictures there. It's the amount of resistance that that heart is meeting. How wide or how clamped down are those vessels that the heart is having to beat against? Obviously, the wider, larger vessels, the easier the heart's going to be able to beat, and the more constricted those vessels are, the tougher it is to beat against that. One thing to note with this here is if you have a patient who is hypoxic, that this can actually lead to an increase in vascular resistance. And the final factor that's going to play a role in our afterload is going to be the viscosity of the blood. So essentially, how thick or how thin is that blood? Thicker blood is going to be heavier and tougher to move, as opposed to thinner blood, which is going to be able to flow more freely. And those are the three factors that determine our resistance or our afterload. And at this point, we've covered all the different factors that go into determining our cardiac output, from our heart rate and stroke volume to breaking our stroke volume down into our preload, contractility, and afterload, as well as talking about some of the basic principles of each of those. This concludes this lesson on hemodynamics and our cardiac output component. In our next lesson, we are going to talk about how we monitor our hemodynamics.